IVM.
If you like IVM Likes, you should definitely check out another show from the IVM network called Geek Fruit. It's a show where three geeks, Tejas, Jishnu and Dinkar, talk about everything science fiction, adventure, fantasy, movies, TV shows, everything. So quench your thirst for geek conversation every week. Episodes out every Monday and Thursday on the IVM Podcast app, the IVM website or wherever you listen to podcasts. Hello and welcome to a brand new episode of IVM Likes. My name is Abbas. In case you're listening to IVM Likes for the first time, it's a show where IVM staffers and hosts recommend you some cool stuff. And in the second half, we deep dive into a particular topic. Joining me today is Alika.
Hello.
Graphic designer. And Antariksh.
Hello.
Producer of this show. And we have a special guest today with us, Pavan Srinath.
Hello there.
Host of the Pragati Podcast and Thale-Harate. Am I pronouncing it correctly?
Yes, you are.
Okay, cool.
Amit doesn't.
Pavan usually records stuff for us from Bangalore, but he happened to be in Bombay this week, so we took the opportunity to have him here. Pavan is a huge fantasy and science fiction nerd. So in the second half, we will deep dive into science fiction and fantasy, the books, the movies, the TV shows, everything that we like. Amit Doshi will be joining us. But before that, in the first half, we will be giving our recommendations. So Alika, let's start with you. What do you have to recommend?
Oh yeah, I always get to start. This feels nice. I'm going to recommend a graphic novel. And I am a one-track person. Also, I don't have time for many hobbies anymore. So I'm going to recommend this cool graphic novel called Die, D-I-E, by Karen Gillan.
Die, okay.
Yeah, Die. I'll explain why it's called Die in a minute. By Karen Gillan, who's written The Wicked and the Divine, also a very cool graphic novel, and artist Stephanie Hans. Now, it's called Die because obviously die, you know, you die.
Yeah, and I was just about to ask.
Yeah, thanks. I'm getting to it.
Right.
And it's also called Die because that's the singular form of the word dice.
Ah, okay.
It's a graphic novel about a role-playing game. So, basically in this novel, there are like six kids who get together and for one of the kids' birthdays, they're like, hey, let's play a role-playing game. And they're like, okay, cool, let's play it. And so they all get together and they play this fantasy game for adults. And
that sounds a little dicey, to say the least.
Can we put that sound effect?
Was your intervention just for that pun?
Yes. please continue.
It's worth it.
So the adult game for fantasy game for adults.
Yeah,
happens.
Yeah. I mean, because they're like teenagers and they're like, oh, we don't want to play this old boring Dungeons and Dragons game.
Right.
So they want to play a fantasy game for adults. Whatever. They start the game and then they disappear. And nobody knows where they've gone for 2 years, and there's search parties and stuff, and everybody's trying to find out what's happening.
Yeah.
Nobody knows.
Uh-huh.
And then after 2 years, five of them return about 50 miles away in a forest, beaten up, bloody, bruised, all sorts of things. And people have found them, and like they're super happy, and they ask, like, wait, man, what happened? What happened to you? And all they can say is, we can't tell.
Okay.
I can't say it. That's it. That's all they get to know.
Uh-huh.
And then the story kind of flash forwards about, I don't know, 30 years, I don't know. They're adults.
Okay. Uh-huh.
They're adults now.
Uh-huh.
And they all have like miserable broken lives.
Mm-hmm.
Because clearly something happened in those 2 years that has affected them deeply, strongly.
Mm-hmm.
And they all have like really kind of messed up lives, you know, all broken relationships and unhappy marriages and stuff like that. And one of them one day gets a box which has a bloodied die in it.
Mm.
And then they all gather together because this means something. So that is more or less like the plot.
Okay.
I'm not going to get into what else happens because it's really cool and it's super fun. There's a lot of awesome fantasy scenes in the progressive books.
But is it like a whodunit kind of?
It's not really a whodunit.
Okay.
But it's like what happened in those missing years.
What so, done it?
What done it? Yeah.
What done it? Yeah. And so, like, Karen Gillan described it.
Has Karen Gillan written and drawn the?
No, Stephanie Hans has drawn it.
Right.
So Karen Gillan wrote it. He's described it as goth Jumanji.
Ah, yeah. When you said that they disappear, that's the first thing I thought of.
Yeah. So it's like
kids disappearing while playing a game.
Yeah, and it's pretty dark. It explores like different sort of relationships and stuff, and you know that, I mean, it's kind of obvious, like, you know that they went into the fantasy world
right.
for those 2 years, and
right.
like the things that happened there, it gets explored in the books right. beyond yeah. and you see, like, there's some really twisted shit happening there.
Okay.
Because it kind of deconstructs fantasy in a way, like, you know, you take these things for granted and then it's like, what the heck are we doing?
Right.
What are we doing? No sane person would do this. No sane person would, you know, just commit genocide of an entire race because, you know, two people of that race came and stole the princess or whatever.
Wow, you just gave away like a huge
plot
point.
No, I didn't. I just made that up.
Okay.
But it kind of deconstructs some fantasy tropes and stuff, which is really cool. And it's a very interesting book.
Cool.
I think there's a couple of
volumes. Is it a, like, yeah, I mean, has the entire run completed?
No. I think I've read 6 issues, which is 1 volume.
All right.
I think. There are a few more.
Okay. So the comic is called?
Die.
Yeah. And where can one read this?
You can probably find it on Comixology.
All right.
Also, I do want to point out, he has made the actual RPG in which this is based, because it's not Dungeons and Dragons, but it is a different system. So at the end of the book, you find the actual rules for the RPG that they played in the book. It's really cool.
But wait, you mean die as in D-I-C-E, right? Not
so D-I-E is the singular version of dice. Dice is plural.
Oh.
Yeah,
and die is a singular.
The first time she mentioned this, you were busy on your phone, Antariksh.
Sorry.
Alright, so that was Alika's recommendation. Pavan, what do you have for us?
So I have a couple of things. Uh-huh. One, in TV, I think Apple TV, which launched recently, has some amazing shows. Mm-hmm. I'm a fan of C. Mm-hmm. I'm also a fan of For All Mankind. Mm-hmm. And
I've only seen the morning show and it was okay. I didn't quite get into it.
I've heard C is great. The Jason Momoa show, right?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
And For All Mankind starts with the simple premise, what if the Russians got to the moon first? Because Russians were the first with Sputnik,
right.
sparked the whole sort of race,
right.
And the Americans sort of won it with
the moon landing,
right.
And then stuff proceeds in a different way. The Soviet Union crumbles. Here we don't focus on the Soviet
Union
much.
You mean Russia didn't have a Stanley Kubrick to shoot?
Yeah,
fake moon landing.
They could fake it first,
right?
So, and they ask that what if, and basically Neil Armstrong and co get scooped,
right.
by I think Leonov.
Mm-hmm.
Who was the first Russian on the moon? And then what happens? And this is a Nixon administration.
Right.
Wow. So how would a Nixon administration
react to
them winning it?
And I think it's a little procedural in a way, or more than procedural, it explores the astronauts, mm-hmm. the partners and the wives of the astronauts,
right.
the potential of how problematic it is to have only male astronauts,
mm-hmm.
and can there be competition there too? And they really, really explore, and it's a wonderful what if and a sidetrack.
So, do you have actors playing Neil Armstrong and Nixon?
Oh, yeah.
Okay,
but they're not the primary characters.
Okay,
and I think with Nixon and others, I think now between deepfakes and, you know, good voice actors, you don't really know what's Nixon and what's not.
Right, exactly.
And Nixon said enough absurd things, and he's recorded everything that he said.
Yeah.
So you can probably mix and match something from his tapes and actually use it in the film.
Right.
So really tough to tell. So it gives you that sense of realism really well.
But for the most part, this is like a drama show, right? Like a serious show. It's not nothing funny or something.
No, it's not funny. It's a serious show.
Yeah.
But the scenes they show of the moon are stunning.
Mm.
I mean, I wish there was real footage like this. But we've seen a lot of Mars recently with
Correct.
The Martian and others.
Yeah. Right.
It's amazing to see the moon. It's almost like the entire thing is in black and white, but not.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
And they do that really, really well. So if you love The Martian and others and want a taste of just the visuals of the moon, they come few and far in between because the show does take place primarily on Earth.
Right.
But definitely.
These alternate history things are like so cool, man.
Yeah.
I think there's a movie in which the Germans won the Second World War.
That's also The Man in the High Castle, the Prime Video show. Is what if Germany won the Second
World
War.
Exactly,
yeah,
that's what I heard of. Yeah, all these.
And to me, the second recommendation, and this is stemming from this. The okay. To me, the granddaddy of all what ifs. Uh-huh. And there's a book by Kim Stanley Robinson called The Years of Rice and Salt. Came out uh-huh. quite a few years ago. He's also better known for the Mars trilogy, Blue Mars, Red Mars,
okay.
Green
okay.
Mars.
I haven't heard about
and this
no.
what if is basically what if the bubonic plague in medieval Europe
yeah.
wiped out 99% of the population instead of a third mm. of the population. Mm. How would world history change?
Right.
And he uses sort of the Buddhist concept of the bardo, which is like a group of souls who are often reincarnated together till they find release and moksha and nirvana.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so sort of had these characters coming in different ways. In some, those two souls would be father and son. In another, they might be friends or lovers. And they keep getting reincarnated. So again, they don't have any memory of their past lives.
Okay.
They're
thanks.
Just independent people. Yeah, this is not incense. And he follows what would have happened. So he... I think around the time the bubonic plague hits there, Timurlane is trying to get into, I think, Bulgaria or
right.
somewhere else.
Mm-hmm.
And because there's this pox, he sort of turns away. So you have flashes, you know, from the 1500s, then 50 years later, 100 years later, and you go to China, you go to Kerala, you go to other places, and you explore 500 years of this world.
Mm-hmm.
Where Europe was not dominant.
Mm.
That sounds so cool.
Yeah, it's a granddaddy of all motives, as far as I have read or
right.
seen.
Who's the author?
Kim Stanley Robinson.
Got it.
And what's the book called?
The Years of Rice and Salt.
Ah, okay, yeah. Cool. Anything else you would want to recommend?
I have an anime to recommend.
Sure.
Yes.
So
yes.
I'm often careful with recommending anime because I myself have gotten into the... it's not a genre, but the medium in the last few years. My
right.
partner Winona introduced me to it,
mm-hmm.
and it's been a wonderful dive in afterwards. But there's one recent anime called Kanata no Astra.
Okay.
It's about a world where space travel is possible. There are multiple habitable worlds you can visit. Most people stay on one world called... and
do you know the... Sorry, did you know the English translation of the name by chance?
I think it is Spaceship Astra, I think.
Okay, okay. Yeah,
nowadays,
okay.
I'm reading them in watching them in subs, so
okay,
I forget
I
the English
yeah,
name.
Yeah,
so Kanata no Astra follows a bunch of school kids who are supposed to go on to another planet on a camping trip.
Okay.
Except something goes wrong and they get flung off somewhere else. And everyone back home has no idea what's happened to them.
Oh.
And I'm recommending this show because it's an easy first anime for a lot of people. Because I don't want to recommend an 80s anime like or 90s mm-hmm. like Cowboy Bebop and
yes.
say, oh, you want to start
totally
there.
Yeah.
You should not start with Cowboy Bebop. But Kanata no Astra is a great place to start. It's 12 episodes. It's tight. The story is tied in 12 episodes.
Oh, it finishes?
Yeah, and
nice.
Is not too meta, doesn't use too many of the things that are in the sort of anime sphere with, you know, various in-jokes and other things.
Mm-hmm. So it's about a group of students though, right?
Yeah, young group of students. People. Group of students this, thrown out in space.
So this kind of reminds me of another anime which is, I think, also very new. I think in the last few months when it's come out. Have you heard of the Promised Neverland?
Oh yeah.
You heard of this?
The darkest.
It's amazing. So the premise,
anime.
Yeah. The premise is...
I saw
yeah,
the...
Antariksh and Pawn aren't having the same reaction to it. Antariksh is too enthusiastic and
yeah,
Pawn likes
I get fascinated
thing.
By these things. Yeah. The premise for Promised Neverland is about these crews, these orphans grow up in this orphanage. And they're told never to leave
duh.
The...
Please continue.
And so they grow up in this orphanage and they're told never to leave the boundaries of the orphanage.
Uh-huh.
Because it's just, okay, because you're not allowed outside. That's what they're told their entire life. And they stay in the orphanage till the age of, say, 12.
Uh-huh.
Because at the age of 12, they are sent out and they stay for adoption. One day, two kids go out and see that no, outside is basically just a world of demons.
Mm.
And these children in the orphanage are being bred.
Mm.
To be fed to these demons. And that's their entire
yeah.
purpose in life. They are basically livestock for these demons.
You just gave the whole
No, that's the first episode. This is literally just the
yeah.
first episode.
He hasn't spoiled anything.
Yeah.
But again, I would not recommend this anime to anyone who's new to
getting
anime.
Getting into anime, yeah, for sure.
Because you watch The Promised Neverland, yeah, you're going to be scarred, yeah, and never want to watch anime again.
I mean, it is a little dark, sure.
Just a little.
I feel Antariksh's glee. This is a little unnerving.
I like this one. It's really right, good.
Cool. So you recommended For All Mankind?
For All Mankind, The Years of Rice and Salt, and Kannada no Astra.
Cool. Kannada no Astra, by the way, is Astra Lost in Space in English.
Oh, okay, nice.
Antariksh, what do you have for us?
I have a very quick recommendation of 7 Days in Hell. That's a 7 Days of
that's recommendation. Your recommendation.
No, yeah, that's the name of it's a HBO mockumentary starring Andy Samberg and Kit Harington from Game of Thrones.
Oh, okay.
And they play tennis players.
I know what you're talking about. Yeah, I haven't seen it, but it looks hilarious.
Yeah, it's a 7 days long match that they have. It's apparently like a historic match that took place in history that they have basically like parodied. And like basically all the people from SNL make it onto the mockumentary as commentators of sorts. And Serena Williams is there.
I watched this too late at night and had forgotten to describe. It was amazing.
It is, yeah. Please watch it again if you don't remember right now. But it's really funny. And Kit Harington's character is a guy who is not confident about himself, so he uses the word indubitably like a million times in every conversation. He's like, so what's your name? Indubitably, my name is whatever his name is. And it's damn funny. There's like a scene where Andy Samberg's character is a very famous tennis star. Okay, so during the match, during the 7 days long match, I think on day three or something, a naked chick comes onto the court, the tennis court, and Andy Samberg's character starts having sex with her in the middle of the match.
What is this?
It's just a hilarious mockumentary.
Okay.
It's too funny. Please check it out.
What's
7 days
called?
7 days in Hell. You can watch it on Hotstar, I think, right now.
Okay, cool.
It's an HBO documentary.
This is so different from everything else we've recommended.
My recommendation is also an HBO documentary, which I was very surprised no one had recommended it. It's called Veep, starring Julia Louis-Dreyfus.
It's not a documentary.
Did I say documentary?
It's not a mockumentary.
I meant an HBO comedy.
Yeah. Comedy show.
An HBO comedy, which, well, halfway through the show, kind of happen in real life. Anyway,
I think Veep. The only challenge is I think they've been eclipsed by Trump. Unfortunately,
exactly.
The show was extremely hilarious.
So the show stars Julia Louis-Dreyfus as a fictional vice president of the United States called Selina Meyer. It's about her and her staff around. It's a political satire. I remember somewhere they took an anonymous poll and most US politicians said that Veep is the show that's closest to reality in the White House. I don't know how to explain it. It's just about the ambitions and the sheer pandemonium that goes on day to day in politics in the White House, which I'm sure is the same across the world. I'm sure it's the same in the office of the Prime Minister of India or whatever other country. Just how cutthroat and ambitious politicians are,
foul mouthed.
Yeah, essentially, you're behind the doors look at what goes on in these circles.
So many great characters. Who's your favorite character in Veep, though?
My favorite character. Joan Ryan is one of the most despicable characters and I mean that in a good way. The redhead mustache guy in Selena's
Matt Walsh is the actor.
Matt Walsh is
Mike something is the character's name.
And what I love is, I mean, if you look at political shows, right, to be the three archetypical American shows would be sort of one, The West Wing. The idea of, look, there are different people pulling in different directions, but if you do good politics, then you can align them all together for the greater good. And they showcase it, time after again. And it's iconic. And then comes sort of House of Cards, which is like a response, right? Which is like, look, everything is about naked, ruthless ambition and sort of pursuit of power and people destroying everything in the process. What I love about Veep is people are petty. Forget grand ambition and being the mafia thug. You're a petty moron with petty concerns and everything's a snafu. And the idea that it's a snafu and not this grand Machiavellian thing where somebody is moving all the levers, but everything's chaos all the time,
Everything is chaos,
and everything's accidental. It's like, from this to what we talk about later, the Malazan Book of the Fallen, everything is about it's like Lock, Stock and Two Smoking Barrels of Snatch, right? It's like a good Guy Ritchie movie where people are doing their own things but they all collide and crazy stuff happens.
So I mean, it's the like small running jokes, like for example on election night, one of the staff members has ordered a boat. Now he realizes they're going to lose the election. So the whole night he's busy cancelling the boats that do not, you know, and here people are, you know, aghast that they're going to lose the election lose power. And someone in the background is like, no, no, don't send the boat, you know.
Okay.
So there's just small things like that. I'm in season four right now. Okay. Antariksh has seen the whole thing.
Yeah,
so,
I do. Can I say one of my favorite jokes from the entire show is Jonah Ryan at some point.
Jonah Ryan, by the way,
is one of the characters.
When the show starts, he's like the go-to guy from the president's office. He's the point of contact between the president's office and the vice president's office. VP's office hates him.
So everyone on the show basically hates Jonah Ryan's character. And at some point in the show, he starts running for president. Okay.
What?
Okay. Sorry. This is bear with it. He starts running for president, and he's running. He has this meeting with these people who want to fund his campaign. So he's at the meeting. Okay, and they're like, okay, we really want to fund you. We're interested in your campaign. He's like, I have all these radical, amazing ideas that I think you guys will be really, really huge on, really, really big fans of. They're like, yeah, shoot, tell us. He goes, I believe that America in 5 years can put a man on Ellen DeGeneres, and it bursts out laughing.
Oh my god!
I love that joke so much.
Yeah, it's a crazy show. Julia Louis-Dreyfus won 6 Emmys for it. The writing team has won a bunch of Writers Guild
Awards. I think
Julia
Louis-Dreyfus got tired of winning Emmys so far from the show.
It's on Hotstar. All 7 seasons are on Hotstar. So please watch it. It's each episode is like 27 minutes, so it won't take you a long time to binge the entire thing. That was my recommendation. Before we go into a break, let's recap once again. Alika recommended.
I recommended a graphic novel called Die, D-I-E, by Kieran Gillen and Stephanie Hans.
Pavan, once again, the three things you recommended.
The show For All Mankind on Apple TV, The Years of the Rice and Salt by Kim Stanley Robinson, and Astra Lost in Space.
Nice.
The anime.
Antariksh.
I recommended HBO documentary 7 Days in Hell. You can watch it on Hotstar.
Mockumentary. You said documentary.
I'm sorry, HBO mockumentary. Yeah.
And very fictional show Veep from HBO on Hotstar is what my recommendation was. Alright, we'll take a quick break. When we come back on the other side, we'll have to say bye to Antariksh, and Amit Doshi will be replacing him, and we will have a deep dive conversation into fantasy and speculative fiction in general. We'll see you on the other side of this break.
Hey everybody, welcome to another awesome week on the IVM Podcast Network. If you aren't following us on social media, please make sure you do. We're IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. Also, quick reminder, please do fill out our survey. It's at ivmpodcast.com/survey. It's a listener survey. We're trying to understand more about who's listening to our stuff, what kind of things you would like to see from us in the future, what you have been seeing so far, what you think of it, what shows you like, all kinds of different stuff. Also who you are, right? So I mean, like all kinds of different stuff. Just please do come in and fill it out. It would be really helpful. That's ivmpodcast.com/survey. Want to thank our sponsors this week, Cambly, Intel, and Storytel. Remember, sponsors are what make this stuff possible. So if you enjoy the content, please do thank our sponsors. We have two new shows releasing this week. Lakshmi Krishnan, better known as Literary Chills on Twitter, talks to agents of literary culture on her show Litnama. She plunges deep into new genres of literature born in the digital era as she talks to the performers, storytellers, bloggers, poets, and writers. New episodes are out every Tuesday from 10th December. The Traveling Professor's Diary is hosted by Siddharth Deshmukh. It's a show about a curious human being with an eagerness for travel and observation. He visits colleges such as MICA, SP Jain, Symbiosis, Flame, Upgrad, Talent Age, and spreads the digital gospel of design, marketing, and business transformation. Episodes are out every Tuesday and Thursday starting 10th of December. This week, The Seen and the Unseen celebrates its 150th episode. Amit is joined by publisher and editor V.K. Karthika. She talks about her journey of publishing and highlights the need of diversity in a publishing house. This week on IVM Likes, Abbas and Alika are joined by me, Amit Doshi, along with Pavan Srinath, who hosts our Pragati Podcast and Thale-Harate. We discuss our favorite fantasy fiction movies, books, and everything else. Do tune in. It's quite a fun conversation. And we talk about all kinds of weird stuff. On Storytellers and Storysellers, Vineet is joined by storyteller Anisha Dixit, better known as Rikshawali, and storyteller Tracy D'Souza, former channel head at TVF's Garliapa. They talk about the future of women creators in India, how they work with brands, and how their teams perceive them as leaders. On Ganatantra, Saryu and Alok unpack what happened in Maharashtra after the assembly polls and how the office of the governor has been misused to meddle in state politics. On Edges and Sledges, Ashwin Varun and DJ focus on the India vs. West Indies T20 series. On GayBCD, Sunetra and Farah talk about relationships and breakups as they share their experiences of navigating through the same and learn to acknowledge their feelings. It's a crossover on the Empowering series as Zarina is in conversation with Chetna, host of Positivity Unlimited. They talk about her shift from the corporate world to life coaching, about positivity and self-belief. On 9XM Soundcast, Eva is joined by Bollywood singer Benny Dayal. They talk about his experience of working with A.R. Rahman and some of his favorite composers in Bollywood. And with that, let's get on with your show.
And we're back. I'm still here with Pavan and Alika. My name is Abbas, and joining us for this round is Mr. Amit Doshi.
Of course, you're talking about the stuff I love to talk about.
Yeah. So as we mentioned, in the second half, we were going to deep dive into epic fantasy and fantasy in general, because Pavan is someone who is a big fan of fantasy. So am I, so is Alika, and so is Amit, so which is why we're here.
And I'm so happy not to be talking about public policy.
Yes.
There is no fantasy in public policy. There's only...
Well, public policy in some ways is a fantasy.
That is true. That is very true.
I was thinking about this when I think when you came down to Bombay last time, you spoke about the fantasy series that you were reading, and it just struck me as a contrast because on your shows you talk about such stark and serious things. And
I try not to take the topics of myself too seriously, but yes, we do end up spending time on too many serious topics.
All right.
But fantasy fiction is serious business.
It is serious business.
Absolutely. Do you spend as much time reading anything as a long fantasy series?
Exactly.
I mean,
and I'll tell you, for me, I can only read epic fantasy books and fiction books. Mm-hmm. Non-fiction, I read papers and articles. I can't read a book because if you're really invested in a good fiction book, right, what you want to do is turn the page.
Right.
If you're really invested in a good piece of non-fiction,
you want to think about it.
No, you want to Google Wikipedia to find some weird term that you found somewhere and you want to go down. And therefore, you don't proceed with the book.
Right.
Whereas with the fantasy, you have to turn the page to find out.
That's true. Alika, I know for a fact, draws a lot of things inspired by fantasy.
Yes, that's like my job. Just pointing it out.
No, but you also do a lot of like stuff on your Instagram account, right? Which is like fantasy art.
Because I got into doing a lot more art because of fantasy. Mm. I saw Lord of the Rings at a very impressionable age, like everyone.
That was was an opportunity to plug your Instagram account.
Oh, yes, I will plug it at the end of the episode.
Oh, so now not just a plug, but now a teaser to the plug.
Yes, that's how things work, right? So give a trailer and then...
So I was curious, so your gateway was also the Lord of the Rings, the movie?
So I remember seeing the first movie when I was like 13, I think. And I really enjoyed it. And then I went and asked my parents, hey, this is like a cool fantasy thing. Have you heard of these books? And my dad was like, yeah, I gifted them to your mom for her anniversary and she never read beyond 60 pages because she said I was dumb. And I was like, what? Then I found out where those books were kept. Extremely old. You know, like, I think they must have been like first or second edition books. Super old, falling to pieces. And I was on vacation in, I think, Shimla. And I had like 5 days and I had those three books and my parents were like, they're going to stay back where you're not going to take them with you. So like, I have 5 days to finish this, guys. I finished Lord of the Rings, all three books in 5 days. This is my proudest book reading achievement.
It should be.
Yeah.
Lord of the Rings is...
When I was 14 years old.
So my Lord of the Rings story is kind of the polar opposite, if you will, right? So I've always been a big reader, but mostly mystery, spy books, those kinds of things, right? Mm-hmm. I was in college and somebody, like, you know, when you're in college, everybody's reading Lord of the Rings. So they're like, you should read Lord of the Rings. I'm like, okay, sure, I'll read Lord of the Rings, right? I couldn't get, like your mom, I couldn't get past 60 pages. I've tried 4 times since then. I have not been able to get past, like, 100 pages of that book. And so I just completely was like, you know what? Fantasy, not for me. It's not my thing,
wow.
Right? Yeah, so then, like, I think this was 94 when I was doing, when I was trying to attempt to roll drinks. I did not touch fantasy for another 10 years or so. And then Harry Potter. That was my gateway.
Yeah.
Wow.
Soft fantasy.
So, funnily enough, for me, it was the first Harry Potter book, and this was a friend recommending it as, hey, here's this cool book that's out there. And this is before it had sort of blown up in India, before book 3 and 4 had come out, I think. And I read it, and it was a cute book. I enjoyed it, and I forgot about it. And then it became a thing 2 years later. Then I had already read the first one. Oh. So till very recently, I owned everything but book one. Because I bought everything else after that. Binged everything. But while Potter was always great, and I've lost count of how many times I've read it, it was still Lord of the Rings, which was the real game.
Really?
Yeah. And I watched the first movie. I think the first movie came out a couple of weeks before my board exams, if I'm not mistaken. But it came near home, so the entire family went. And we made a tradition, including my grandma, to go watch all the movies.
The movies were great.
The movies were great, but the books were better.
the movies, I think, do the thing where Peter Jackson cut out all the fat and only kept the juicy stuff.
There's no Tom Bombadil. Did you fail on Tom Bombadil?
I didn't even get that far. I failed at the mines of whatever.
Moira.
The mines where they're after before the meeting at the Elven place.
We're having this conversation where you're making a lot of boo-boos about the timeline of the Lord of the Rings, and people will come after you.
Okay, no, but I'm thinking.
I feel like you stopped at the Barrow-White scene.
Okay.
Must be.
Could be. I have no idea. I honestly don't remember. I went a little further than when they were hiding from Dark Horseman guys.
Barrow-White.
So I went a little further than that, but I think that Mordor was after the mines were after they left there. I don't think I got that far. I'm pretty sure I didn't get that far.
And Lord of the Rings was great, and then it was this deep dive into the Silmarillion.
So did you read Lord of the Rings before Harry Potter or after Harry Potter?
After.
Okay.
Well, Potter was still ongoing.
Right.
But Potter came first.
Right.
Lord of the Rings after. And then it was this dive into Silmarillion. And then it was this wonderful blend of fantasy and like pretend history, right? Written as a history book.
Yeah.
But if you're a history nerd and a fantasy nerd, it's gold.
Yeah.
And then you get into the crazy territory that is those 12 volumes that Christopher Tolkien published based on his father's letters, which is the histories of Middle-earth,
right, 1 to 12.
And that's mad. And that's the first time you get a glimpse of early drafts of Lord of the Rings. You know, like Strider Aragorn is called Trotter in the first version. Okay. Some ridiculous
Not a very badass name.
Exactly.
Yes.
And so you see the evolution of this over drafts. And it's extremely wonkish, nerdy stuff. Who reads first drafts? And who even has access to first drafts of novels from authors? I mean, you don't get that for Potter.
You don't. No, you don't. So there are a couple of new authors who do this, right? They have like these big beta reader groups. So like Brandon Sanderson does it. Jim Butcher does it.
Brandon Sanderson, to me, is one of the best living authors.
Yeah, so I have a little, I don't know what you would call it, but like a kind of initials, which I call Joma Borussa.
Okay.
Jordan, Martin, Butcher, Rothfuss, Sanderson. Five masters of modern fantasy.
Why are they all guys?
Because I made this thing before I read N.K. Jemisin.
That's it.
And I'm trying to think who else.
Ursula Le Guin, Robin Hobb.
I think Ursula Le Guin is okay. I'm not the biggest fan.
Robin Hobb is a little YA, right? I might be mistaken.
No, she's not really YA, but she's really emo, right? I mean, like, it's a really... come on, are you telling me the Fitz... I've read the Fitz and Full books. They are extraordinarily emotional.
Yeah, so...
But they're very emotional to the point where, like, you know, it's a different kind of story. It's a good story. I like the story, but I would not, I don't know that I enjoy those at the same degree that I would enjoy these.
So
right?
Do you enjoy, like, the world building more than the characters?
So
is that what
I
you
like,
enjoy?
Yeah, I like world building. I like political stuff happening in fantasy. I like you know, having to find, like, you know, these crazy earth bending weapons and, like, you know, the power that those weapons have. Mm-hmm. I like magical systems. I like all that kind of stuff, right?
Okay, so you like more of the hardcore scientific, not scientific, yeah, but like the actual world around rather than the character journey.
I'm pretty much the same on that.
Yeah.
I mean, it's always a treat to have a character whom you can really get into the skin of. But a lot of the times, even in good fantasy, your characters are sort of almost like smiley faces, right? You can imagine yourself in those shoes.
That's
and
what they are.
You go on that wild ride.
Fantasy at the end of it is a wish fulfillment genre, right? So, I mean, like, I love
it. But given how many men are protagonists in this, I think it's easier for wish fulfillment.
Fulfillment.
It's easier for wish fulfillment for a guy than anyone else. I think that's one of the big problems with it.
That's, yeah, I think
one
that's
of
fair.
many problems yeah. with the genre.
Yeah, but that's changing. I think the newer writers, the modern writers, are taking steps to make sure that there's more representation, there's more the more female characters or just characters in general. Yeah. Also, fantasy generally had this perception of the Europeans.
Yeah, it's very white, right? Euro.
Yeah, which is something that George R.R. Martin was criticized for, and then he had to sort of make a defense about it.
But I'd rather he defend it, however, rather than it becomes a thing where Nagini gets retconned with a Korean woman.
That was terrible. That's like J.K. Rowling putting all her first drafts here. Like, yeah, read my first drafts. No, please don't ever show them to
me. No, and sorry, like retconning diversity is bad, right?
It is.
Let it be. And it's like,
you can write something new, you know?
Exactly.
Yeah, I mean, so there's this new fantasy series. The first book is called Children of Blood and Bone, which is Africa. Okay. It's set in Africa. It's high fantasy, but set in Africa. There's G. Willow Wilson, who wrote the Miss Marvel series. She's written a book called Alif the Unseen, which is kind of a Arabian Nights, Egyptian Revolution hybrid of fantasy.
There's also, I think, Shadow of the Crescent Moon.
That's Saladin Ahmed. Yeah,
He's which never written another book, has he, after that?
He hasn't. So he tried to crowdfund his next two books, but it's kind of in a limbo right now. Okay. So
And N.K. Jemisin is fantastic in the light of all of this. Yeah. But even before that, right, you have Robert Jordan, and I love the Wheel of Time.
Yeah.
But he writes women so poorly. It's exhausting to read Robert Jordan's women. I mean, they're all nagging whoever is the male protagonist in the same scene.
I have a point of view on this, right? I'm not saying that he's completely unproblematic. He's not completely unproblematic. But I think that there is a deliberate attempt over there to... So the way that the world is structured to the Wheel of Time, right? Women essentially have the power men do.
Yeah, right? I agree. Yes.
And I think that there is a slightly deliberate attempt over there to show women as domineering in that culture the way men are domineering in this culture. So
domineering in this culture don't nag.
They don't.
And most of the domineering women in Wheel of Time nag.
Well,
in the worst way possible, like pretty much no one I can think of in real life. And I understand the dynamic and what he was going for.
Right.
And I do get that his wife was his editor as well. And she's quite interesting.
Right,
and it's a pleasure listening to her.
Uh-huh.
But Robert Jordan, especially on a reread, it really jumps out.
Again, a lot of these things, when you reread them, then you kind of start seeing the ticks and you kind of start seeing the... things which are not so pleasant. And I'm not defending everything over there, right? I'm just saying that I feel like some of the criticism is not reading the text as it's meant to be.
Right, and that's an entire another ballgame on how he's supposed to read a text. But it was great to read him and George R. R. Martin well before the whole TV show hype and everything.
Yeah.
And in a sense that for the longest time, Lord of the Rings was the reference point, right?
Because
pre-Lord of the Rings, it was fairies or it was sort of sword
there
and sandal
Swords
fantasy.
Swords of Shannara, which was kind of a rip-off of Tolkien stuff, but then went on to be big anyway.
All those are derivatives, right? And some response to Tolkien in one way or the other.
Right.
Before that, it was Conan the Barbarian and
the sword and sorcery stuff.
And I like what Tolkien did. I like that elves became a thing which are not, little... Irish mythology creatures into something entirely different.
Uh-huh.
But now the new reference point is also Game of Thrones and Song of Ice and Fire for everyone.
Oh, yeah. I mean, what do you think of Grimdark? Guys, thoughts?
Grimdark as a genre?
Yeah.
I'm not a fan.
I'm a huge fan of the Glenn Cook Black Company series.
I like that stuff too.
And would you call Malazan grimdark? Or it would be reductionist to call Malazan grimdark?
I think it would be reductionist to call Malazan. So I would think grimdark is stuff like Prince of Thorns, King of Thorns, Emperor of Thorns, that kind of stuff.
I like it in certain quantities.
Yeah.
But to me, it's the world building at the end of the day that is the primary draw to epic fantasy.
Right.
And I don't think anyone has imagined a world as large as the one by Steven Erikson and to a lesser extent by E.N.C. Eslemo on this is Malazan Book of the Fallen.
Right.
And that I still cannot. If you think Game of Thrones is big, if you think Robert Jordan and the Wheel of Time world is big, this is massive. Each continent has multiple civilizations, multiple people. There are humans, gods. There are old gods, new gods. There are previous races that existed in the world with different levels of powers. And even the idea of one single concept that I want to share out of context with everyone is how he reimagines the idea of an avatar. So if you have gods and mortals and an actual transactional equation, instead of an avatar being the personification of a god, he actually splits it into three. Because you have a god and their followers. So you have, I think, the shield anvil, the mortal hero, and the destroyer.
Yes.
And the idea is that one person is the sword of the god, right? He is the sort of the punitive part of that god. And the shield anvil is the one who...
The protector.
The protector, and the question is what happens to the souls of the people who work in the name of this god.
Right.
And the destroyer is like the healer, right? And it's wonderful. You can read in Indian Hindu mythology, trinities and this if you want. You can do other things today. But I thought, I mean, just this conceptualization was so unique. You have characters who are explicitly anti-civilization. They think that civilization's bad and, you know, we should all go our separate ways. And what I love with Erikson is that it's a direct... thing from Dungeons and Dragons, and he's saying, I don't care about Tolkien, I don't want to read Tolkien.
Right.
And Malazan fights were gamed in Dungeons and Dragons style again and again and again before the plot line could be read, which is why every time you have one of those sort of you know, everyone comes together, it's a cluster of hell, and you never know what's going to happen because he's gamed it to death.
Right.
So the most unpredictable and bizarre outcomes
appear. That sounds like right up my alley. I feel like I need to read the
Malazan. You never read Malazan?
Okay, I'm feeling some judgment here.
It's okay.
I'm surprised.
No,
so I'm younger than you. I have time.
No, you, of course you have time. The thing is that Malazan is a famously difficult read.
Is it?
I mean, a lot of people...
No, I'm going to read it in one day, just you watch.
Well, I think that might be tough just physically, given how big the series
there
is.
There are 10,000 pages across 10 books.
Yeah.
That's all.
Yeah.
And the worst part, the first book came out as a one-off and written by two authors.
Oh.
And they had no idea that it's going to be picked up. So book two comes out, I think, 6 years later.
Right.
There were a lot of problems in the first book, which, you know, like with most first books, you have to write them off as one-off discontinuities, which don't fit in. And the magic system got firmed up by book two. And I think it really picks up speed by book three.
It does. Well, no, book two is Chain of Dogs, right?
I think that's four.
Oh, is it really?
Yeah, but between two and three, it picks up. So you need to invest like 1,500 pages to start getting value, value out of it.
Yeah, which is always a tough challenge to do.
So if 60 pages in The Lord of the Rings is a problem, then...
But you've read Malazan.
I've read... I haven't read the last book.
Oh.
Basically, I started reading Malazan when the last book was still to come out. And so I read up till then, and then I just never got to the point of reading the last book.
So I want to know how you didn't get through 60 pages of Lord of the Rings, but you did this 1,000-page payoff.
So I think I learned a little bit more about how to read fantasy.
Okay.
With Malazan particularly, right, it's very important that you don't try and make sense of every little thing you're reading.
Okay, yeah.
Right? I mean, like, if you try and find, like, through lines throughout the book or books, you'll go nuts.
Yeah. I do have that issue when I read fantasy. If things aren't easily understandable in the beginning, it does turn me off a little. I'm like, just say what you mean.
Exactly.
Don't tell me, like, these half-truth things.
So, complexity needs to come later in fantasy. That's something that I kind of think is true, right? It needs to start simplify.
Erikson is still something else, because I've done a full read, and I've finished half a reread. My brother's completed two full reads. And even now, I understand probably about 25% of all the plots. And I think it's... That's by design.
It is.
Okay.
And so it's quite unique in that. So even Game of Thrones and others, how much ever complexity there might be,
you can sort of figure out. Yeah, you know what's going on, right?
Yeah.
You have arguments to make. Like in the Wheel of Time, what was the big the big debate on Wheel of Time for the longest time? Who killed? So there's a character called Asmodian.
Spoiler alert.
Well, I mean, like, is it that much of a spoiler? He dies like within like a couple hundred pages of showing up.
in the book number.
Isn't Asmodeus like a god of hell?
It's inspired from the same name.
Yeah, it's inspired from that.
The Dark Lord in Wheel of Time is Shaitan from...
Right. Oh.
Yeah.
From everything.
But so I mean, like, who killed Asmodian, right? This was something that for the longest time was what Wheel of Time people would debate. Mm-hmm. There were five or six different points of views, like long theories. There were websites at the time which are devoted to this idea of debunking different people's theories. Mm-hmm. So I mean, like, you know, this was what people used to talk about and stuff. So, but the thing is that there were coherent arguments to be made on all sides. Oh, I think this person killed because of this reason, this reason, this reason. I think this person killed because of these reasons. You can't make those kinds of things in Malazan.
Okay.
Malazan, your theories are not going to hold up like that.
Okay. Do you enjoy theory crafting? Like when you read series? Do you like, you know, going on forums and being like, oh man, I bet this person's going to be revealed as this person's father or whatever.
It's a lot of fun.
Yeah, no, it's honestly, guys, it's the genesis of IVM. It's how this is how I got into podcasting. Because I used to go to Harry Potter forums to find out what people used to think about different theories. Yeah. And that kind of led me to Harry Potter podcasts.
Right.
And that led me to podcasts.
And this led me to forming one of my first email groups.
Oh, really?
I think we were all the children of Eru.
That's so cute.
I think that's one of the appealing things about fantasy. Again, whatever part of the world you go to, you'll find this small community which is so dedicated to whatever fandom you're talking about. So
also, fantasy lends itself very well to theory crafting because there's always that one element that the author has not necessarily revealed.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, when you're in the middle of a series, it's like, so how is this possible? Here is my theory, and you can be as ridiculous as you want. Magic exists. It's fine. So then it really entices you and kind of fuels that anticipation. Like, I bet he's going to bring in this kind of magic system, or this is going to be revealed. Because I don't know if you remember when Mistborn came out. Just before the third book, everyone was giving these theories as to how the main protagonist was getting these powers.
Mm-hmm.
And some theories came super close, like super duper close.
I think Brandon Sanderson is the opposite of Erickson in that sense, right? His stuff is as scientific as it can get in this fantasy. Everything has cause and effect.
But this is on one axis, right? There are many books which model through magic, where magic is everything is ex machina, everything is pulled out of a different pocket. Honestly, a lot of Potter also falls in that.
How did the flying car show up at the flying car
had a bond, okay? He had a bond with Ron.
And are you kidding that every single time turner disappeared? And enough of these absurdities. So, but Erickson is also internally consistent.
Uh-huh.
So is Sanderson. But they're on very different spectra on comprehensibility and
comprehensibility, I think, is
of
where,
the thing.
Yeah,
and Sanderson in every single book series creates a brand new magic system that is airtight. One where magic comes from color. I think there's a Warbreaker,
that's right.
And then Stormlight Archive, it comes from a different source, from these friends in the air.
Yeah.
I love that he's constructed it carefully, and that's what builds theory,
it's a
right?
Spoiler for me, I haven't.
It's
a premise, actually. Yeah, you start, you know.
Yeah.
It's a premise itself.
Was it? Cause
I'm very, very keen on not giving out spoilers.
Yeah. Cause again, this was a book I read in a hurry because it was my brother's. He was lending it to me and he was like, you're leaving in 2 days. Finish
the first,
the first book. Yeah.
I'm seeing a pattern here, Alika. Someone gives you a challenge of you have these many days to finish the book.
This is also how I read the first Harry Potter book. Don't at me.
So the other fantasy fiction question.
Yeah.
Yes.
How many of you have read or written fan fiction?
I have.
Who hasn't
written
fan
Star Wars fan fiction?
I used to write like a random.
I wrote Tolkien fan fiction and then I stopped.
I don't think I've either read or written.
Did you write self inserts?
No.
Oh, come on, you're lying.
So, it didn't go long enough for that.
So a self-insert when you put yourself in the story?
No, because I had read a lot and I. The idea of a Mary Sue or a... What's the male version of a Mary Sue?
A Kylo Ren.
Gary's too.
Yeah, Gary's
okay.
too.
Right.
Also known as Batman.
And were there everywhere. And the best of fan fiction did not involve all of this.
Mm.
And the best of fan fiction, for me, and this is where the Hobbit movies... punched me harder than anyone else, because I was writing fan fiction just based on the appendices of the Lord of the Rings, on what happens when Gandalf leaves the dwarves and Bilbo and goes his own separate way.
Yeah.
And my whole thing was, okay, if you're going to assault Dol Guldur, there's a way to do it.
Right.
And I don't want to get lost in that. But that was amazing fodder. And when I heard that The Hobbit is being made into a trilogy and he's going to explore that too, I was delighted. I was like, okay, there's going to be serious world building that happens here. And oh my god, was it a train
disappointing.
Wreck? Or is it a barrel wreck? I don't know. One of the two.
A disappointment, yeah.
But reading fan fiction was also fantastic. And Tolkien, right? I mean, for all the many flaws that we have, I loved that there were fan fiction authors which explored those flaws, which even in the elves, the kind of sort of racial divisions, the fan fiction explores someone from, say, the wood elf community instead of, you know, the light elves, and sort of explores what kind of differences there might be. So in fan fiction, I really like that kind of exploration, which Tolkien himself personally was not a big fan of.
Right.
He famously against allegory. He's like, this is my world, it's its own world.
Yeah.
Don't make it subservient to the real world. Yeah. You're diminishing the value of my world. But I mean,
it's obvious though that you have to take something from the real world to make this fictional world, which is...
Yeah, also, I mean, like, authors don't have control over their creations once they're out there. Right? I mean,
that's
just the nature of these things, right? If you put something like this out there, people are going to have their own interpretations of it.
Right.
You don't get to say what other people's interpretations are.
But at the same time, you do have books like His Dark Materials, which are meant to be allegory.
Yeah, of course.
Which is like amazing. I love it. By the way, not the biggest fan of the two new books which came out, but they're still pretty good.
Two new books?
Yeah, Book of Dust and The Secret Commonwealth.
Oh my god, what hole have I been hiding in?
What?
Book of Dust was a big deal.
I did not know.
Okay, so yeah, hang on, peeps. So Book of Dust and The Secret Commonwealth basically explore Lyra's life after the whole events of His Dark Materials. Technically, only Secret Commonwealth does Lyra after His Dark Materials. Book of Dust focuses on pre-His Dark Materials.
Okay.
It's like a prequel, but it ties into The Secret Commonwealth, which is a sequel. Not the biggest fan. There are some issues I have with it, but they're still pretty enjoyable reads. I'm very excited for the TV series, which I've not yet seen.
So is the TV series going to incorporate elements from the
I doubt it, because he's still writing the third one in it.
Okay.
But, you know, he's done with His Dark Materials, which I loved. Amazing.
So which fantasy series, according to you, had the best ending? Which author or which creator ended? It's one thing to go on a quest with these characters. Which one concluded it the best?
Best ending. I know what the worst ending is, and that's the Game of Thrones TV series. And it's a blot on all our memories.
Most
and
people know what the worst
ending is. Do you think Martin will do anything? I mean, of course, he'll modify.
He better.
He's
not going to modify it that much, I don't think. Yeah, he will, right? He's already halfway through the sixth book.
Yeah,
he's going to go two more after that, I think. I think he said it's going to be 8 instead of 7.
Did he say that?
I think I remember hearing that somewhere. But I
prefer to be Gandhian and looking at Martin's readings. I don't want to know until there's an actual book out in the market.
Fair enough.
I started the damn series in 2006. It's been 13 years. I'm reading other people.
Yeah.
You come up with something, we'll see.
I started, I think, when Feast of Crows came out. So that's around 2006-07 only.
And Rothfuss has been on the same path.
Right. Versus again, another. So that's the thing, right? You're asking about best endings. How many of them actually end?
That
I guess is a question, right? So the Wheel of Time is done. I like the Wheel of Time ending. I think it was interesting.
The Wheel of Time had a satisfying ending.
Yeah.
I think Malazan also has a satisfying ending.
I will find out
ending.
Soon.
You should read
it. I will find out soon.
And it's.
I'm trying to think. What else have I read that I really liked that ended?
I really liked Robin Hobb's series ending. It made me cry many tears.
That is the reason why I didn't enjoy it so much.
Did you read all four trilogies?
So I haven't read the ship one.
I know which one you're
talking about. The boat one. Basically the one with the living boats.
Yes.
I haven't read that one, but I've read all the other. I've read everything else she's written about.
Okay, but that one like explains a lot.
Yeah, okay. But I don't know if I need that much more
explanation.
Never mind. Yeah.
But I cried many tears at the end of it. I'm like,
You know who ends... Sorry to meet you, Trav. But you know who ends fantastically? Guy Cavriel K. Every book is standalone.
Okay.
And he does great endings.
Okay.
Like Tigana is, in my mind, probably the... Have you guys read Tigana?
No.
No?
I haven't read K at all.
No. Okay. So the difference between K and everybody else is K has great plots, yes, but language is beautiful. Most of our other fantasy writers, I mean, like, you know, they do serviceable storytelling, but let's be honest, language leaves a lot to be desired in most cases, right? But K writes beautifully, right? And so he's got... So Tigana is, in my mind, one of the best single standalone books I've ever read. Just, it's incredible. The conceit of the story is... essentially that there is a so every book he does is a analog to a real life historical period. So this is Italy during the Florentine period, and during one of the revolts by a country called Tigana, the most powerful wizard slash king's son dies, and he lays a curse on the land that nobody can say its name. Even though people might remember the name, they can't say the name, right? And then from there, kind of how it turns into a story of revolution, and just it's just a beautiful story. There's another one he's got in, which is Chinese mythology from the, not Chinese mythology, but China from the Ming Dynasty, called Under Heaven. Again, beautiful book. He's phenomenal. I mean, like, if you guys haven't read him, I couldn't recommend him more than that.
In light of this, I mean... Perhaps in complete contrast to a lot of things that we've discussed is Lev Grossman and the Magicians. I mean, here's my pitch, and I've pitched this to many people. Imagine if Harry Potter takes place in college and not school. Now, imagine if all years of the school happen in the first book.
Oh, okay.
Now, you're Harry, but you don't quite have a Voldemort. You have magic.
Also,
you don't have a Voldemort.
You're a serious asshole. Let's not forget that part of it.
And you don't have Dumbledore. There's no Dumbledore. There's no Dumbledore in real life.
There is no Dumbledore,
What happens? And that's the premise. And there's more that I'm not going
to
reveal.
I mean, like, the key thing that you are neglecting to mention over here, right? The number one thing. Most fantasy protagonists are likable. Quentin is not.
I agree.
He's not. He's not just not likable. He's like you. You're just like, man, you're a dick. You know, I mean, like, that's just what goes through your when you're reading this guy, right? So to me, that's the problem with the Magicians.
Yeah, I mean, there are many others where you have compelling protagonists. You have protagonists who are all powerful, or become all powerful, or some who don't but are unique and strong in their own way, like Frodo and Sam. And you have unreliable protagonists, which is fun to read, but not necessarily invest a year of your life in.
Right.
But yeah, I agree with you in how Lev Grossman turns this part around too.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of allegory to... sorry, why am I blanking on the name?
C.S. Lewis.
Yeah, there's a lot of allegory to C.S. Lewis as well. So there is... You don't have Narnia, but you have something else.
I see.
And but Lev Grossman, even now, I think... Even the TV series, I think, is doing really well.
I've heard it's
And it's a great way to enjoy all of fantasy because people in the show keep dropping fantasy references. Right? So yeah, I mean, they grew up in a world where Harry Potter is a book and Lord of the Rings has been published. But they're fiction, but what's happening in the book is not.
All right, so finally, apart from books, any fantasy movies or TV shows that you've been catching up on or you'd like to recommend or that gave you kind of the same feeling of immersing?
Honestly, one of the best things to come out in the last few years, I think, is Altered Carbon, and I think it's underrated.
That was a great show.
That's been recommended.
And I think
I did an Altered Carbon recommendation.
I think Altered Carbon is what Blade Runner should have been. But most recently, I know people are divided on this
but
show.
Is Altered Carbon fantasy, though?
It's science fantasy. It's fantasy-ish.
Fantasy
it's close enough, right?
All
right.
When you there's a whole part of sci-fi versus fantasy which we didn't go into because that will be a really big conversation.
I just go speculative fiction. Okay. Because, I mean, like, for me, I'm happy with both of them. The things that I look for have commonalities in both.
I mean, stuff like Dune and Star Wars, obviously, are sci-fi under a fantasy blanket or umbrella.
So is Asimov.
Right.
I think only Arthur C. Clarke and a few others actually go towards hard science fiction. Where they deal with hard scientific concepts, and that is critical to the plot of the thing, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, Asimov, psychohistory is
fantasy. Psychohistory is fantasy, dude. Yeah. I mean, like, I'm sorry, I love Asimov, but psychohistory is fantasy.
Psychohistory is fantasy. The three laws of robotics are fantasy.
Yes.
I remember getting into fights in school with people in sort of science debates and competitions talking about, you know, there are three laws of robotics. No, that's Asimov. That's not science.
All right. So,
Altered Carbon. And most recently on Apple TV, there's the TV series C. Honestly,
so
I think
we do a show called Mr. and Mrs. Binge Watch, which talks about TV show, and they didn't quite like the show. So
I don't know how much into epic fantasy fiction they are.
That's true. I haven't found out. Yeah.
And honestly, there are many people who have tried a post-apocalyptic world in the recent past. I think Shannara or something else also
was
a TV series. Yeah.
There was one which I kind of liked a little bit was it's called Revolution. The first season of it was interesting. I liked it conceptually. The show was okay in execution.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But the conception was, what if electricity stops working?
Right.
And then how does the world kind of move from there? I kind of like that idea.
And here also it's the same idea. What if everyone in the world turned blind?
Mm-hmm. Ah, okay.
And how would life evolve? And honestly, I think it's one of the best roles Jason Momoa has acted in till date.
Okay.
And one of the deepest roles. And I have newfound respect for the man.
Okay.
And I would recommend the show.
All right.
And we're drifting into sort of speculative fiction and other territory here. But For All Mankind and other things are also really fantastic. Really fantastic.
Okay. Amit, you have something?
So I haven't really watched that much recently, but I think I spoke about this once earlier, but I've gotten really into a subgenre of fantasy, which is essentially the Wuxia stories. So Wuxia is like Chinese martial arts fantasy. Mm. I've been reading a lot of that. Mm. So I think
Ken Liu, I think, has written a trilogy.
So that's a little different, right?
Okay.
I think the Ken Liu one is the three-body problem, right?
Right. Sisin Liu, I think.
Oh, okay.
Ken Liu is another fantasy writer who incorporates Wuxia in his
fantasy. Oh, okay. All right, I should check that out because I'm always looking for good more stuff over there.
Right.
But I like the idea, right? It's martial arts. It's, again, wish fulfillment. Train yourself hard and you will succeed. Right. I mean, like, it's all that kind of stuff. So I enjoy it. But I've been reading, I've been reading a bit of that.
It felt like you were suddenly talking about Naruto or something. Train yourself.
Oh, yeah.
You'll be the president of the...
Yeah, I guess that might be true, I guess. But
a lot of fantasy anime also out there.
Yeah. So let's not get Pavan started on that.
Record of Lodoss War.
Anything you want to...
Hey man, I watch kid stuff because it's fun.
Sure.
Not because it's got great world building or whatever. But watch She-Ra and the Princesses of Power. Good fun fantasy. It's on Netflix. Also watch Hilda. Good fun fantasy. It's on Netflix.
Not a sponsor.
Not a sponsor. Yeah, no, there's a lot of good kid shows which actually have really great world building and stuff. Steven Universe is awesome. Gravity Falls is great. Over the Garden Wall, I've plugged this before.
Yeah.
They're all really good, fantastical kid shows.
So, am I right? Goblin Hunter, is that right?
I've not heard of that one.
It's a Netflix show. It's something I've seen on Netflix. I think it is Goblin Hunters.
Troll Hunters.
That's an
animated
show. Yeah. The other thing I'd recommend, based off of this, also on Netflix, is The Toys That Made Us.
Mm.
I love it.
It's about how
G.I. Joe toys and how so much of what we know as TV and pop culture were basically marketing campaigns for toys.
It's a toy show very squarely aimed at adults.
So it covers G.I. Joe's. I think there's a new season out.
Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, Power Rangers.
And I had G.I. Joe's growing up. That was the only one of the entire lot I had.
They did a Masters of the Universe episode as well.
I did have a He-Man,
I would recommend The Orville, which I have recommended before on the show.
I like that show. I've seen that.
The new Star Trek show, Discovery, is getting more into the dark space, whereas Orville is the new... It's more optimistic.
It's Stargate.
More,
It's essentially Stargate SG-1. I enjoyed it. It's nice. It's fun. It's like fun, nothing. Yeah. It's what you want for some of this stuff. You don't want. Not everything needs to be like deep, dark, and
exactly.
You know, intense.
And a movie I saw, which I really liked, was Ex Machina, which was Alex Garland's film. I thought it was a very good, well-made science fiction film recently. All right, guys. Thank you for joining us. We could go on and on talking about fantasy and science fiction. Very quickly, I would like to know, where can one follow you, Pawan?
At Zeus is Dead on all social media platforms.
All right, and we can listen to you on the Pragati Podcast and
Thale-Harate Kannada Podcast.
Right. Pragati episodes out every Wednesday and Thale-Harate out every Thursday.
Yes, sir.
Amit, where can one follow you?
Doshi Amit on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, I guess, yeah.
And you can listen to Amit on Shunya One and Cock and Bull.
Yes, I think that's the ones I do.
Alika?
You can find me on Twitter and Instagram at Cape Fox Alex. That's a plug. And you can find me on IVM Likes
and
occasionally.
All artwork on the IVM website.
We're kind
app.
Of all, not M- all.
Most
all.
Of it, yeah.
Most of it.
All right. And you can follow me at Abbas Momin on Twitter and Abbas Momin 88 on Instagram. Thanks, guys, once again for joining us. If you think we missed out on something that we should have spoken about in fantasy and science fiction, please write into us. Use the hashtag IVM Likes. We shall see you on the next episode next week. Till then, bye-bye.
Remember the last vacation you took? What about the one you took 3 years ago? Okay, how much do you really remember? It's a question I've asked myself often over a decade of traveling the world. Hey, I'm Utsav, and I do not travel the world for a living. I have a full-time job and responsibilities, but I have made traveling the world a priority. Priority enough that I negotiate extra leave in my job contracts, obsessively track my frequent flyer miles, and I'm willing to take off at the sight of a cheap ticket. Yes, I am cheap. I have lived and worked in 3 countries. I understand human behavior for a living. And these experiences have given me unique insights into places, people, and culture. With over a decade of travel behind me, I increasingly realized one thing, that we cannot see everything. So whatever we see, we must see deeply. Because as the film of memory decays, the imprints which will stand the test of time are the ones felt by the immersion of the senses, not by fleeting encounters with them. Postcards from Nowhere is an immersion into the world of slow travel, one story at a time. Tune in every Thursday on the IVM Podcasts app, website, or wherever you get your podcast from.
How many times have you caught yourself Googling stuff on health and wondering if it's the right information? How many times have you heard different health experts give opposing views, which has only left you confused? There are rising cases of cancer, heart, diabetes, stress, and autoimmune diseases. Meet the patients and the experts who paved the path of true healing. Join me, Rachna Chachi, cancer nutrition coach and nutritional therapist on Heal and Hearty. I take you through my own journey of recovery from an incurable disease and the journey of so many others who healed only via nutrition and holistic healing. Find the answers you seek for what's good for your health and what's good for your soul. You can listen to us on the IVM Podcast app or ivmpodcast.com. Don't forget your date with good health.